What's up, Facebook family? How you guys doing? How you guys holding up with the quarantine? Everybody doing okay out there? Wanted to take a second, make our second nutritional video, and just go over some more content and help you guys while you're at home trying to make these nutritional decisions and help in any way that we can here. So today we're going to talk about three topics. We're going to talk about protein, we're going to talk about fats, and we're going to talk about the metabolism. Okay, these are three key components that sort of build on what we talked about last week and helping you sort of paint a better picture with your nutrition and make better decisions. So we talked about the first macronutrient last week, which was carbohydrates, and that should be about 50% of your diet. 25 to 30% of your diet should come from protein. And protein's kind of tricky because it's really difficult to get that type of number, to get 30% of your calories to come from protein. You really have to be deliberate when it comes to getting protein. It's easy to get carbohydrates. They're found in, you know, most everything. Protein, you have to be very deliberate and you really have to pay attention to it. And if you were to track it sometime, I could guarantee most everybody falls short here unless you're making sure that you're getting protein in most of your meals and snacks here. So protein's primary function is it builds muscle. I mean, we are made up of a good portion of protein. Our muscles are protein. So anytime we work out, we tear down those muscle fibers and we drink protein shakes afterwards and we fill in those torn fibers. That's protein. That's how protein synthesis happens, and that's what we want in order to build lean tissue. And the more protein you have, the higher your metabolism regulates. So muscle doesn't burn fat, but more muscle raises your metabolism, which does burn fat. And so protein is very important when painting your complete nutritional picture. And when we think of protein, we oftentimes think of things like beef or whatever. And beef oftentimes gets a bad rap. And it's not that beef is terrible. It's just there's so many different types of beef when it comes to steaks and cuts and fat content that the biggest issue with beef is there's lots of cuts and types of beef out there that have really high fat content. And that's more the problem than beef itself. Extra lean ground beef and lean ground beef is fine. It's just making sure that you're not getting, you know, traditional, you know, ground chuck beef that's got, you know, 30 or 20% fat in there. When it comes to meats in general, don't focus so much on the type of meat really as the fat content when it comes to weight loss. When it comes to beef or chicken or fish or pork, look at the label and see how much fat's in there. We also have this false sense of security when it comes to things like chicken and turkey. You would go, oh, it's a turkey burger, it's gonna be a lot healthier for me. And that's not the case sometimes, because there could be turkey burgers and chicken products, whatever, that have high fat content. It's not like turkeys don't have fat. You know, so whenever you're getting something or you're ordering something, you really want to know the fat content on that. So don't lull yourself into a false sense of security simply because you're eating chicken or beef. Make sure the fat content is less than 10% when you're choosing your options there. When it comes to fish is generally low fat, so that's sort of a safer zone to go into that you can sort of just purchase indiscriminately and without having to worry about high fat contents on most of your meats there, most of your fishes there. Things like shrimp, it's great for protein content. It's very high in cholesterol, so you have to be mindful there. Not that you should eliminate shrimp from your diet, but just be mindful that it does have a lot more cholesterol in it than a lot of other seafood and fish does. Once again, the importance of protein really is getting it up, because when you exercise and when you work out, you need protein to help build that lean tissue. So you really have to be deliberate in making sure that those numbers are high. And how you calculate that is this. If you're a guy, you want somewhere between 1 to 1.5 grams of protein per pound of body weight. So if I'm a 200 pound guy, I want to get somewhere between 200 to 250 grams of protein per pound of body weight there. Okay? If you're a female, that number is going to come down to about 0.75 to 1 grams of protein per pound of body weight. So for example, if I'm 150 pound female and I want 0.75 grams times 0.75, that's going to be 112 grams of protein. So I gave you a range there because it's really hard to get in the correct amount of protein. So I sort of put a lower number, like for guys, 1 gram of protein, for females, 0.75, to sort of start right there. You may even go below that just to start ramping up your protein intake. For guys, you may start at 0.75, and for girls, you may start at 0.5, you know, half a gram of protein per pound of body weight, until you can routinely get used to consuming that much protein and finding ways to get protein in your diet. Because essentially to get those numbers, you really have to have protein in your breakfast, a good amount of protein in your breakfast, in your lunch, and your dinner. You know, so when you're having breakfast, protein shakes are really easy as far as just getting your protein count up without having to eat a ton of meat or a ton of alternative, you know, because there's soy out there, there's almond milks, and there's all kinds of other, you know, protein sources. So you don't have to do just meat, but it's one of the easiest ways to get it. But a protein shake really adds to those numbers and helps you get that protein content up there. So let's move on from that. Let's talk about fats next, okay? When it comes to fats, you want about 20% of your diet to come from fats, okay? We sort of have this idea or this misnomer that all fats are bad. You need fats. I mean, fats surround your cell membranes and they help your body move more efficiently. So you want to make sure that your fat content, your healthy fat content, is where it needs to be. However, with that being said, there are a whole host of dangerous and unhealthy fats, things like saturated fats and trans fats are terrible for you, okay? You don't see trans fats as often as you once did back in like the 90s and 80s because everybody knows they're terrible for you. So there are a lot less products with trans fats. However, there are a lot of things with saturated fats. So when you're looking at something, you should really look at that saturated fat line to make sure that's not too high. You want to really look for healthier fats like monounsaturated fats and polyunsaturated fats. Those are your healthier fats. Things such as nuts and olive oils, avocados, flaxseed, soy milk, peanut butter, things like that are going to be a lot better as far as healthier fats. Now, with that being said, if you have too much good fat, it becomes bad. Okay, too much fat or too much anything is bad. So don't think, oh, it's an avocado, I can have a ton of it, you know, or it's, you know, it's olive oil, I'll just use a ton of it. Okay, when you get too much, it also becomes detrimental to your goals. So make sure that you're having it within a healthy range. A lot of bad fats, real quick, easy way to think of like saturated and trans fats are things like high fat meats, chicken with the skin, cheese, butter, commercial pastries, vegetable shortenings, packet snack foods, candy bars. Those are things you really need to be mindful of, that sort of line of thinking, because those things are just gonna, you know, tank it for you right there. When it comes to things like soy or almond milk, I encourage those for those who are lactose issues, or if you just prefer that. But when you look for those, make sure you're looking, they have two different kinds. They have fortified and unfortified. You want the fortified kind because what they do is they put in things like calcium and vitamin D back into or into the soy milk or into the almond milk because those things are missing, which are contained in traditional milk. But soy milk and almond milk don't naturally have them. So they fortify some of those and put those calciums and vitamin D's back in there. So if you're looking for products that are almond milk or soy milk, make sure it says fortified. That way you have those additional benefits in that milk as well. I want to finish by talking about your metabolism. Okay. Your metabolism rules the day. It really is going to help you greatly or hinder you significantly because it's what utilizes the fuel in your body and burns it up, and that's how we experience weight loss. When your metabolism is elevated and we burn through calories, that's how weight loss occurs. And so I have a couple of crude graphics that I wrote out for you here. Forgive my lack of artistic nature here. And so basically this is what the traditional person looks like, and this is where we find a lot of pitfalls. So we have breakfast right here, you eat breakfast, and then your body has to break down that food, breaks down the food, and then your metabolism elevates to do that, okay? And the once broken it down, then it starts to crash again, it goes down, then you eat lunch and it comes up again, breaks down that food and it lowers, and then you eat dinner and your metabolism elevates and then it comes down and you go to bed. And so the benefit to eating, is your body has to elevate the metabolism to digest that food. And so that's where those peaks and those valleys occur. What's good is this, up here, this is what we want. We want the metabolism up at its optimal range, burning fuel, okay? These valleys are what are killing us, okay? That when the metabolism is just super low, it's doing nothing for us. And so what you wanna do is introduce snacks to keep that metabolism up there, okay? It's gonna sound crazy, but eating more is beneficial. Now, that doesn't mean eating a ton more for your meals. You need to actually bring your calorie counts down oftentimes in your meals, but you need to implement strategic snacks throughout the day. And I'll give you another crude graphic here with my Sharpies. to show you what that looks like. So here's my breakfast. Okay, your metabolism elevates. And then about halfway between breakfast and lunch, I'm gonna have a snack. And so now my metabolism has to ramp right back up. And then it starts coming down a little bit. I have my lunch, it comes back up, another snack, and it goes back up. And now my metabolism is staying up here all day long instead of crashing. And so I sort of put some times on there so you sort of see what that would look like. For example, if I wake up at 7 a.m. and have breakfast, okay? And if I have lunch, if I have breakfast at 7, lunch at noon, and dinner at 6, or you can, you know, make your times whatever work for your life. But if you get up and you eat breakfast at 7 a.m., if you split through that 5-hour difference, it's about 9:30. So have a snack, you know, have some almonds, you know, have a piece of fruit, have something that get your metabolism up there. And then you have your lunch, and then between lunch is 12 o'clock and dinner is 6 p.m. There's a 6-hour window, so halfway between that's 3 o'clock. So around 3 o'clock, have another snack. Now, like I was talking about yesterday with carbs, I would avoid having fruit, you know, after lunch, just because it's high in fructose, which is naturally occurring sugar. So I would go, this is where a great thing for like nuts or maybe some string cheese or just a low calorie item or high protein item is very beneficial. But this is how eating more frequently burns more calories. You can literally eat 2 or 3 times more than you are as far as frequency and burn more calories. So, but also it's gonna help curb your appetite so you're not as hungry. So when you're sitting there, you've got these snacks. So when you get to lunch and dinner, you're not just starving, you know, and you're eating way more than you should be because you strategically put those snacks in there. Never skip meals, okay? If you skip a meal, what you're looking at here is oftentimes the most skipped meal is probably breakfast. When you skip that meal, this is what happens. The body's been sleeping for approximately 8 hours. You wake up and you're in a catabolic state. The body is feeding off itself, okay? You skip that meal, right? You probably haven't eaten dinner since 6 or 7 the night before. You get up, you skip that meal. You don't eat till lunch till noon. So 6 p.m. when you ate dinner till 6 a.m., that's 12 hours, plus another 6 hours, that's 18 hours. That's 18 hours without any fuel, without any food. Well, the body's primary goal is to stay alive. It's not to make you look good, okay? It has to keep you alive. So what it does, it goes, listen, I'm gonna do two things by skipping this meal. I'm gonna lower the body's need for fuel, so I'm gonna lower the metabolism, which is not what we ever want, okay? And then what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna start feeding off one of the richest sources of fuel we can find, which is muscle. So it starts burning up muscle for fuel. Okay, so now we've lowered the metabolism and we're burning muscle, which is the exact opposite of things we want to do. So that's where you never want to skip a meal. If you skip breakfast or you skip a meal, you're going to wake up not hungry. That's because you've conditioned your body to not send those hunger signals off to your brain. So you've conditioned it to sort of operate in starvation mode. It's something as small as just starting by eating something simple. Maybe it's just a yogurt in the morning, or maybe it's just having a banana. And then after a few weeks, your body's going to be hungry because you've conditioned it to get fuel when you wake up. And then you can begin to add to that and eat more, a more traditional style healthy breakfast. There's a lot of details in this. So if you guys have any questions to these, if you're like, well, you know, what's, you know, there's a lot of things as far as what's a meal look like or things of that nature that you may be questioning, whatever. So feel free to ask me. But this sort of paints a picture and gives you an idea of sort of how to structure your diet, structure your day with your meals and things like that. Gives you a better understanding of proteins, fats, and your metabolism and meal frequency and snack frequency. So hopefully if you implement these, I think some good changes will come. So once again, if you have any questions or need anything, let me know. Hope this helps. Love you guys. Talk to you soon.